Hi, right, my name is Louise Clark, and today I want to look at NOSEE programming as part of MKUltra programming and looking generally at NOSEE, but really it's to help those that have been programmed with NOSEE programming. Again, it's like some would say that you need to have all the memories. What I want you to do by, hopefully by watching this video, is become aware to start looking rather than be blinkered, like Trump said in his, he said over in his video, for some reason, to keep looking. So, I'm gonna have to do it in parts, and so it will have to go through Vimeo first and then onto YouTube, no doubt, because I need to use the computer as well. So. It's quite a complex one, but I'm gonna go for it. So I'll start off with some sort of verses from the Bible that help to guide, I find, in what way one should go, because one's programmed and therefore led down avenues that may not be in line with the Lord. Okay. Then the eyes of the blind shall be open and the ears of the deaf shall be unstopped. Isaiah 35:5. And so I haven't read that chapter, but obviously it's talking about at some point people's eyes do get opened and their ears do hear, and maybe it's talking about these times, I don't know. I'm not the best at this, I'm new to the Bible really, relatively. Okay, and it says we don't yet see things clearly, we're squinting in the fog, peering through a mist. But it won't be long before the weather clears and the sun shines bright. We'll see it all then, see it all as clearly as God sees us, knowing him directly just as he knows us. And that's 1 Corinthians 13:12. I looked at the different variations of Bible translations of that verse and they vary, but I quite like that one because it was fitting. And yes, I mean, it is like squinting through a fog, really, and I'll try and explain why. So when we look at, start looking, we're looking at gang stalking is a major part of keeping the programming in place, because the programming was done, I mean, people have got these myths of, oh, they went for programming. No. You're programmed from birth, really, programmed from before birth. Some people may be just after birth, but it has to be done before the age of 5, or it won't work, is what I'm understanding. So the programming is done, but obviously it needs to be kept in place, because it's done through breaking the mind up into pieces and keeping those pieces separate from each other, so the right hand don't know what the left hand's doing, the right brain don't know what the left brain's doing, and so forth. Therefore, if one was allowed to go on in life, we would heal the pathways that join between the right and the left, say, and therefore the program would start breaking down, because they like these altars to be separate and not know what each other are doing, because then what you think you are living your life with is all you think there is, and it's more, because then other altars will be utilized in other ways for other things that you may not agree with, probably don't agree with, else they could ask you to do it. Therefore, to break them walls down that have been created through trauma, to stop the sides communicating, naturally that would occur. So what happens is in life you'll have things to reinforce those programmings, to reinforce those belief systems, to keep the altars in their place. And I mean, they can take you in for reprogramming, but the system is not built to work like that, really. It's built for everyone to keep everyone else, everyone's keeping an eye on everyone else within that structure, with all those people that come under the umbrella of the matrix, have been structured to tell you what's real, what's memorex, how to perceive things. And if you start seeing things differently, if you start showing recall, then there's people there to reinforce it, to enforce the programming, keeping it in place. Through families, they'll use cross programming often, so each sibling will keep each other in line with the thinking, and no one will really start to remember. If the memory started to come and the barrier started to break down, then that would be reported by someone's reporting auto, and we'll all have a auto that will report. And it's not about, oh, we're grasses, we're not even aware that we're reporting. We'll go and report without being aware that we're reporting, and that auto may feel obliged to report things, because if they weren't to, there could be serious consequences. So I hope I'm becoming clearer that you can see. Now, therefore, the gang stalking fits into that remit, because they're there to reinforce. Now, what a lot of the time, you know, you can have gang stalking that's not visible to you, that you'd have to really look and notice. And then you have gang stalk that's in your face, that they want you to notice them there. And if that is the case, it's about they're trying to reinforce a programming of we are everywhere, we see everything, we're the all-seeing eye. And the alters inside would have been programmed in that, knowing that you can't escape, the matrix is locked down. And really, it's not as tight as they want it to appear, although it has become tighter over the years due to electronics and so forth. But it's not as tight, but they need to reinforce that we are everywhere and we see everything, and if you was to go against us, then there will be consequences, and your other alters would have seen what the consequences were for people who did go against them, who did wake up. So the gang stalking is sort of there partly to say, we are everywhere, we're watching you, we know. And also they're there to sometimes trigger, cue up those alters, because alters can have cues that are like signals, hand signals, eye movements, sounds, names. Usually they're a combination of different things so that they don't sort of get cued by accident. But if they need to be cued, the people who are paid to do the gang stalking will then give the cue. But everything is on a need to know basis. So I mean, if you go through a town, you will see, say, a gang stalker that you always see standing on the corner with their phone to text and say, yeah, they've passed or whatever. But the thing is, that's the same gang stalker for the whole people in that area, really. And so they don't want that gang stalker to know all your cues. And so it gets a bit complex that they only give them if they really have to. But just by having that gang stalker there can help to keep the alters inside quiet, in place, not sharing with the other parts of yourself an awareness of even who is there. And so the first thing is to start looking. And, you know, they'll program you to sort of be blinkered and not look. So you'll only look that way, a bit like a racehorse. And so you have to say, well, let me take the blinkers off and let me start looking around me, you know, who is around me, what is around me, where are the cameras, what happens, you know, when I do this, what happens. And so it's about trial and error and start exploring what you see around you. Now also, I'll give you an example. Though the other day I went to meet a young girl who is a MC, and I don't think the handlers wanted the meeting to happen, but it did. When we went in a little McDonald's to talk at the back, and then there was various people coming in to monitor, to watch, to gang stalk, and they were listening. But I had a writing pad with me, so all the pertinent words I would write on the pad, and therefore I saw the guy across the way who was there to watch start tapping his card, like irritated, because first he was holding his phone up as if like, yeah, I'm listening. It was like, well, you're listening to and it, but and when, you're not actually hearing the proper words. And in the end, he got vexed and went off to the toilet, I suppose, to tell him she's writing it all on a piece of paper. So it's quite good if you are going to talk with people to take a pen and paper with you, and then you can write it down and watch the reaction of those around who were just sitting there with their phones. Yes, as I showed in the last video, Trump had a subliminal, a subliminal on his video on Facebook where they was all showing you him all, yeah, great, but the subliminals on the background was, one of them was, keep looking, so keep looking. And they do want you to keep looking because that distracts your mind. Look over there, look over there. And they're steering you on where to look. So they go on about flat earths and all things that, it's like, it doesn't really matter whether they are right or wrong. You've got to look at what really matters, because all the time this matrix is getting tighter and tighter. Our legal rights are disappearing, our human rights are disappearing, and they're preparing for lockdown, really. And I'm trying to speak while I can speak, because you can keep looking. You will find it's very hard to find me, and a lot of people who have spoke really good truth have been removed from the net. So they're saying, oh, keep looking, and maybe keep looking at the net, you know, and that's probably where they got you looking, because they've not got you looking in books, because the books are gradually being removed. I mean, the libraries haven't got many books now. You can go on the net. And then when they censor the net with all the fake news, then we're in trouble, aren't we? Because they're deciding what's fake. Also, I was trying to liaise with someone on the net who is very helpful to me, and all correspondence with that person gets blocked. So it's on Facebook, but it doesn't really matter that it's Facebook, although they're like the worst at the moment for me, is I will write messages to people, but they don't get them. But now it's gone a bit extreme anyway, because at the moment people aren't even getting emails or anything. I mean, I got an email today from my sister via Facebook, and they decided to show me in my email. And then when I looked at it, within minutes after I'd sort of made a call in relation to it, then they put it in the trash for me, whoever they are who's messing with my email account. And it doesn't really matter, people to say, oh, well, you know, change your password. It wouldn't make a difference, because it's like as if they're in the back door of these websites, possibly workers in there or something, and then being DID, they wouldn't even know necessarily that they're doing the task. So it gets a bit complex then, but meanwhile you've got to function, you know. It's no good sort of, oh well, this is happening, I'm doomed. You've got to find ways around it. So it is like with my friend who it's good for me to communicate with, then I know, right, well, if you're gonna make it that I don't see, or she don't see my messages, or either way, then I need to use the phone. And it was the same with the information that was trying to be shared across the net for the last few weeks via emails regarding my situation, my current circumstances. The emails wasn't being received by people, so therefore it's like, well, who do you blame would be the game? But this is it, you have to see that it's like, it's neither side, it's someone else messing with the internet, and therefore you could get angry with either side involved and find that neither are a part of the responsibility for what's happening. Which brings me on to what I looked at in terms of songs that I remember from years ago, because I was programmed with songs. And so if I have a memory, and it's the same for yourself, if there's memories of songs, look at the lyrics of them songs, look at those songs, because if they're stored in your memory, then they may be holding a key to the next part of things. So when I looked at it, there wasn't many, but the first one that came to mind was I Can See Clearly Now by Johnny Nash. And I want to show you this, but I can't show you it here. When I finish these videos, I put them onto my website, higherinsight.co.uk, and I will allocate a page for breaking no C programming. I've done one for no here and for no C. No, for no hear and no speak, but I have to do one for No See. When I do, I'll put the Johnny Nash video with it, unless I come across it in a while. But basically, on the video, you see him singing about, I can see clearly now the rain's gone and so forth, all the obstacles in his way. What you see in the background is boxes. And I will try and show it later, because I'm going to have to do this video bits like this and bits with the video, with the camera on the computer screen to show you other things. When I do that, I'll show you the Johnny Nash, because basically there's boxes in the set. And usually there's clues in the set. It can look like, oh no, it's just abstract, it's just what they've put in the set. But usually they're clues to the programming. And yeah, there's boxes. Now these boxes have like a dot in one corner. And then how they're stacked is the dots go together and so forth. And the thing is, it reminded me of many things. And the first thing it reminds me of is when I used to go for programming, I used to go from school to this psychiatrist, and I don't, even though I supposedly love the guy, I don't remember him really, other than he had a beard and moustache. At the moment, those memories are blocked. But what I do remember, I don't remember talking of any therapeuticness or anything like that. But what I do remember is doing loads of IQ tests and loads of aptitude tests, and my friend who understands all programming explained to me that that wasn't the programming, that was them testing before and after programming, because they were testing to see how it impacted on the IQ, my IQ. So anyway, the dots, what I learned, what I recognized a few years back when I was looking at things is, I think it's called SMART, and there's this IQ testing and education thing, which I'll find at some point and put on that webpage. And they use dots for, like, I don't know, pattern recognition or something. But I remembered the squares with the dots in a corner and having to, like, arrange them, like a sort of little Mensa-y sort of test. So it did relate. And also because many program people have boxes. I mean, different people have different templates. But my template is the one that's on my logo everywhere, which is an 8 dots on a system. I think it's called something like the Wheel of 9 or something. But I don't know, I just know that's what I know my system is built on. And in that each auto is kept in like a box. I mean, it's abstract, but it is abstract. You get the child creates their own to a certain extent. It's like they've got this basic programming, but as they work with the child, they get the child to imagine that program, so the child would imagine boxes, and then they will imagine putting their self in the boxes and so forth. So they'll create their own internal world to keep all the alters in, because if you didn't, then you'd have disorder. If you had all these alters, you know, some people can have 1,000 alters, and it's like, you can't, how are they any use to anyone? They need to be kept in an order. So what they do is build a structure to put them into, and then they're easy to be accessed either by name or number, colour, so forth. So they're kept in boxes, which also the child becomes aware of the boxes, because a major part of programming, from what I see, is like I was kept in a cage to sort of dehumanize you. You have the scientists coming by and you're in a cage like an animal. They just ignore you and talk about you, but they can't see you. And if you make too much noise in the cage, which I suppose all children do, to be acknowledged, to be seen, then they will put you in a wooden box that you won't be seen and you won't be heard, you'll be invisible. So again, for the child, they can understand the concept of boxes and being put in boxes. And what I say is, if we're being invisible, I don't know if I said it a minute ago, but if you're being made invisible, like in emails and so forth, then break it by breaking no speak and start speaking on the phone, and that tends to work. Anyway, now I said about the reporting alters that will be accessed And well, you get access or you get reporting orders. You've got reporting orders in you that will go and report to their handlers of things that they have to report on, and they would be doing that, I mean, partly out of fear, partly out of loyalty. I mean, I don't know my reporting orders, but I want to, and partly they would say that they, you know, sometimes people's orders want to continue doing. They've been raised to believe that it's a good thing. It's all twisted. They've twisted the mind, and also to go against reporting would be a punishable offence. Accessing, as I say, is also if you wasn't reporting and you was doing something out of line with what you were programmed to do, then you would get accessed, and they may use the cues, like I say, the gang stalkers on the street, or someone may come along to give a cue for you to report, to go and allow the accessing. So, you know, this is done without your awareness. It's very hard to see the, it's like it's seamless. It could be a minute, it could be 30 seconds, you could be walking to the shops, and then you've switched out by someone, talk, and then walk on again. And you wouldn't know, it's seamless. Now the thing is, even though it's seamless, there's sometimes signs that it's happened, and a lot of the time for myself, I get tasered and bruised up and marked, and sometimes the bruises and marks that people get could be because they're being like abused whilst they're being accessed. But my marks seem to signify more that I'm getting tasered, and what my friend who understands programming very well says is they're doing that because I'm not obeying, because the tasering is done to make you obey, and I'm not obeying, I'm not going along with it exactly how they wish, and so that's why I'm experiencing the punishment, which I want to address, and I can show you on the video. Because what I recently saw, I used to have bruises, and you'll see them, I'll show them, but really I should go to there now. So we'll call this section one, part one, and then I'll join it to the bit on the video. Okay, thanks for listening, and I'll continue on now to the next one. Bye for now. Breaking no C programming, I suppose we'll call it. So I just wanted to show on Instagram, because what happens is I take photos when I've signed marks, when I see marks. So here's one that I don't know if it'll open up or whether no, oh yes it does. Great. So here's one that I got a few months ago, a burn on my mouth. And what I worked out was the burn come through the window, because yes, initially I thought that, you know, it was being done from a long distance and satellite and all that. But then I realised and learned through Horton. And she was saying, work out the direction, because she gets loads of burns all over her face sometimes. But this was just the night that they told me about her and showed me the video. That night I woke up in the morning with this burn on my mouth. And I knew it was a burn because I was used to getting bruises and taser burns, but taser burns don't hurt, bruises do. Anyway, I could see that it didn't hurt, it looked like a burn, and therefore it must have been done electronically, was my deduction. And then I used to sleep under the window, and I lived on the ground floor, so I saw that it was so easy, because they have these little handheld gun things, machines, that they can see through walls. They can see through maximum two walls, but one wall is easy to see through, and they can see through it, and they can see like the heat, and so they can work out where your face is, where your mouth is. They can work out them things, so it's quite easy. It's not no big skill. They just need you to sit still, as opposed to do it, and I was asleep, so they did it. So these marks, yes, obviously that's they want me to see it, but if they don't want you to see it is usually the case. So I don't know how I'm going to get out of this bit now. Are we done it? Right, so what I want to show you is also what to look for, because you'll have marks if they're accessing you and you're not playing ball, or you might get marks anyway. So yes, let me try and move up here. So yeah, this dot here, I'm pointing my finger, you're not going to see it with my finger, this dot here was under my arm one day, and again that didn't hurt, and it's just a bruise, but it would have hurt at a time. This was a chip that they put in my eyelid, or in my eye, I don't know which, is still there. But when I made my last video of about, and I said about it, then after that I reported and they put it back, so that it's still in the eye, but it doesn't show anymore. So again, that wasn't meant to be that I saw it, I don't think. These are also marks. I'll try and find, they don't, I mean, I do them on the day I notice them, so you can see here. So sometimes they're through the machines, through the sky, but sometimes they're not. These are not through the sky. This is through a taser machine, and you can have tasers that leave bruises, but you also, I was used to them. And also what you see is they're like a scar forming. Now I haven't got a scar there, but what happens is as you deprogram, the alters come forward and the alters are carrying the scar. And this is a bit of the paradox, because if you you may see a bruise, but it don't feel no pain, because them alters are not bringing the pain forward, but it all has to come forward for you to heal, and then you would see the bruise and you may even feel the pain. But these are all bruises, like, that are only showing as bruises and not the pain. And they're not the same as someone hurting you. Now sometimes, oh, that's my garden. Sometimes the bruises do hurt. And I think that's when one is accessed, like here, that probably, I'm pointing again with my finger. This one here, I think, is when they've accessed you. And then you can tell, because they become like fingerprints. And yes, when you touch them, they're tender to touch, like a bruised fingerprint, I suppose. But if they're just through machines, or not just, but if they're done through tasering, then they, these bruises, you see, which is a bit tasery. But that's what I've learnt recently, is I used to get, well, I get these dots on the top of my head, and this is about C, but we'll get to that. I get these, I've seen too much. I get these dots on the top of my head, and anyway, that's my Instagram. I might come back to the eye bit. Well, I can come in a while. But the butts on the top of my head, always on the crown top here, and it's just a tiny little mark, like a little bump, like as if you've been bitten by like a flea or something. And it was only the other day I inquired about them, because it was like I had a couple on my stomach, and I do have them on my body now and then. And so I asked about them, and I learned that they are tasers too, stun guns. And basically the person showed me that they can be like a size of a Tampax, and just two, and they just have to, what my understanding is they have to touch the skin. And so it's like they're put on my stomach, and then leave little marks. They don't have to leave marks. And again, the altar could be so hidden back that you won't ever see the marks. You might feel things and not know why you feel things. And it's because the altar's not forward, or the altar can come forward and you don't feel things, because it's like they're separated off. So scars come out when them altars come forward. What I find is if I'm in the bath, they seem to show more. And it might be because of water, that might be because the altars feel safer because they're at home. Now that was the point I wanted to make. Oh, we've got it here. There was this little card I made because when I found the two little dots on my stomach the other day, I decided yes. And then I realised I've got two little dots all over me, and you never realise. And so I drew like little markings. I don't know if you can see. Drew little markings of the distance of the dots apart, and then I went around my body looking for where they are. I thought they were just like freckles and moles, but when I used this measuring, I found that there were two separate measurements on my body, and that the dots corresponded to one of the two most of the time. Although I am told that, you know, or I'm shown with the Tampaxy one that they could be any distance, but yes, if they're just using a basic gun. And so therefore it's about worth noticing where the dots are on your body, where the marks are, measuring, keeping the measurement, because then it becomes like if you're measuring all the dots on your body and they're all fitting within this two measurements, then it starts to show, no, they're not natural dots, because that is not how dots form on your body. So I wanted to cover that. So while I'm here, I want to deal with the eyes, because as you can see in that one, my eye doesn't look straight ahead. And you see I have a lovely bump on my head, which is another part of don't see. And you learn other explanations for it. It's like, I know when I was visiting my dad, they'd come and say, and they were sort of like, I don't know, heavy people. It's from the gambling world. And they'd be like, oh, where'd you get that bump from, Lou? And I'd go, oh, we hit you on a car. But the thing is, it's never gone away. And you learn these stories, and they may be even testing me to see, do I remember any other reason why I get the bump? I know from my past, my ex used to be hit in a certain part of her head, and that would trigger the auto. And even though that's crazy, and you think, but as well, I remember with my therapist that I tried last year to deprogram with her, she noticed that I had a bruise on both sides of the head sometimes. So it's possibly where they hit me. But anyway, back to the eyes. As you see, one goes to the side, and that really is my left eye. My right eye does all the seeing. My left eye just follows it around, and therefore, I mean, as I thought in the last video, the left eye goes to the right brain, and the right eye goes to the left brain. So when I'm seeing, I see through my right eye, and that's my left brain, so it's all thinking. But the right brain side of the brain doesn't get really looking. And it looks away, or it distracts. Now all my life it followed the other one, the other eye, but now I don't know how much time I got, but now finished. Okay, so now we're on to part three. Sorry how I'm doing all these and bits and bobs, but I have to. So when we're looking just there in part two at the eyes and how my eyes have double vision. And the thing is, they never used to. They used to always be just the right one would see, the left one would follow it everywhere it went and not really play a part. But I think as my programming has been breaking down, I think that's indicated by the defect in my eye, and I'm hearing it through other people how they get double vision, and I can see in their eyes. And it is that if you watched the eyes of someone who's programmed, sometimes you can see then there's conflict between alters, they'll look different ways, and different things are shown. Also, there be disassociation shows where the person's sort of blocked out. And what my friend said the other day, and I think yeah, she's right, is that the reporting alters, and she was saying they won't remember anything they've said because they're disassociated. So it's like the reporting alter is listening, and you find that with people. They say something and then later you say they said it, and then, oh, I never said that, and you know they did, but it's about, no, that would have been the reporting alter that has stored it or wiped it, because some wipe it. So basically I had double vision problems, and it started in 2009 when I was dealing with a case. And I went and they did all tests, and oh, it was thyroid eye disease, and it wasn't thyroid eye disease. And then I cured it, funny enough, with MMS and flaxseed oil. and so forth, and my eyes at the time were poking outside my head and red and swollen and puffy and hurt, and it was typical thyroid eye disease. And then when I cured it, they discharged me and they said, but if ever happens again, you must come straight back. And I didn't really like hearing that, because it was sort of, okay, you're eager for me to come back. And I do think health is a big thing in all this, because I think we're guinea pigs and they monitor us for their health. A lot of us anyway, they monitor us guinea pigs. So getting measured and scanned and all those things weighed, it all seems to, I have that, you know, I've got all the brain scans, I've got everything. And I've been going to a neurologist now for about 4 years, but still can't diagnose. They've done the scans, they've done everything, but they can't diagnose what's wrong with me, even though I give them all my symptoms, it's all clear cut. It looks like MS, but it may be, what my friend says, who's an occupational therapist, is something mimicking MS. And maybe it is something mimicking MS and mimicking cerebral palsy, because I fit into all their sort of tick boxes too. But no diagnosis. Then separately, I have an eye specialist that I, because I returned my eyes a couple of years ago, went double again, or maybe more than a couple of years, or maybe about 4 years ago they went double vision again. And I remember them saying, oh, come back if you have any problem seeing. But I thought, you know what, I'm not coming back, because I think that's an alter, and I don't really want to report to you that my alters are started playing up and the eyes are going out of line. But then after a couple of years, I thought I better, in case, I don't know, there might be something wrong with my eyes and so forth. And so I spent the last couple of years or so seeing the eye specialists and seeing all different ones, and they keep changing their minds. And I said, you know, it could be the muscle tension, because I've got issues with muscle tensions in my body, and maybe that's part of it and it's neurological. And then last year, yeah, they sort of concluded it was neurological. But then when I saw a doctor, an eye specialist last year, by default really, because on the day of the appointment they cancelled it, they phoned and cancelled it, and the doctor wasn't in. But I went early and therefore got seen by the eye specialist, who said that he would see anyone who did turn up. And he did see me, and he was really nice, and he wasn't prepared for me. And he said it was thyroid eye disease. And I said, no. They said it's neuro now. But he said, no, it's thyroid eye disease. And he didn't sound corrupt in any way. He wasn't in no disassociative alter. And he said, no, it was, you've had some sort of thyroid flooding. And they have got me on thyroxine now, which I'm trying to sort of get off of, is my hope, but we'll see. Anyway, my point is that they gave me this string with beads on. I wanted to show you, it's got some name, and you have to practice getting your eyes to converge, to come together and strengthen them. I did it to a certain extent, but I didn't get any better. But when I saw that good doctor, he was like, stop doing that and rest your eyes. And I thought, you know what, I like you, you're a good doctor, and I'm going to listen to your words. And so I then after did try to rest my eyes a lot more and stop staring at the computer, because I was on it most of the day. So now I try to rest my eyes, and also I have sort of perspex in here that helps, it's prism to help me, my eyes bring them together. But that's what I showed in the part two, was picture of where my eyes go a different way. Because when I had the MRI scan, you could see my eyes went two different ways. And then when I saw the eye specialist, the one before that, and I said to him, look, the MRI scan shows that the eyes go a different way. And he said, no, they look normal to me. So there you go, look normal to him. And my sight varies also, and you might find that with programming is different alters see differently. And yes, sometimes my eyes can go very blurred. This week I've been trying to put this video together, but every time I tried to do it, my eyes would become blurred. It's like swell up from underneath and go blurred, like I'd got cream in them. They're not too sharp now. And other times they can be perfect vision. So yes, it's to do with alters. Now it's recording, yeah. So as I've said, I'm looking at bits I've written here, it's hard to put it all together. But what I'm trying to show you as well is, you know, the boxes, as I said earlier, and what I've written here is, yes, the boxes and cages, and it's a bit like in prison. And that is one of the threats that we'll get, is if we don't play ball, we'll end up in prison. And so then we'd be back in the cage again, you see, where no one can hear us, unless they choose to. And the thing is, we're made very invisible with the boxes and the cages, but meanwhile we're watched like hawks. And it's like, that's another thing I wanted to show on a video, so let me come back to that. But what I'm trying to show is that the health, with health we get measured for everything, so I'm sure you're watching who are MCs know, yeah, you get measured for everything, all the health checks and weights and measures, yes, everything, but they can't see. No, can't see what's wrong with you, can't see what your needs are, no diagnosis, so no one else can see either. So I mean, I had problems getting diagnosed, well, I'm still not diagnosed. Don't know what I've written there. Burnt match, can't see. burnt mouth. Oh, right. Yes, the picture that I showed you in part two with my mouth burnt, I put it on Facebook as my profile picture to say, look, and no one, they said, Merry Christmas, Happy New Year. No one could see the mark. No one said, what's that mark on you? And this is it. Only certain people, like I said in that, yeah, they ask about the bump. My dad always used to ask, what's that mark at the side of my nose? And I never knew what it was. And yes, also on them Instagram pictures, you can see where they've prodded inside my eye, and that's caused all sort of bleeding. But yeah, loads of messing with our eyes, really. Yes. Now, eye issue, the double vision blurring, so we see with one eye. I saw that, I said that in the other way. When I look at my family, because they sort of, you know, everything's cross-programming, my sister always used to say, or still probably does, is just ignore the health things, because they say all these diagnoses for her. She gets all these diagnoses that she's doomed, and she just learned, ignore them, don't take no notice of them, because it doesn't make no difference. And so she sort of says, well, they don't really know everything, they just act like they do. And my dad, you'd always say, oh, it's all in my mind. Well, yes, if only we knew how. So now when it comes to you can see the dissociation in people, therefore people could see if you disassociate, and if you disassociate, then they can test to see, oh, how to get you to disassociate, and they can read a lot through your eyes. Therefore, cover your eyes, which is what I say as well with the gang stalking, is cover your eyes with sunglasses, then they can't see your eye movement, they can't see the disassociation, they can't see much. And they'll use neuro-linguistic programming to work out when to put their question to you. And if you put the glasses on, it makes it difficult. Also, there is something of when you're looking at someone, somehow, some energy, some frequency goes to that person, because you can tell, because people look round, and yet they shouldn't know that you're looking at them. So again, I believe the glass somehow blocks that, so it helps to keep you in control, because it is, it's all a paradox of you want to be seen, but you don't want to be seen by people you don't want to be seen by. Oh, how much you're seen. And if you think someone's, you know, a bit dodgy, don't look in their eyes. Don't look at them. Okay, you know, it's like, oh, well, it can mean all that and can mean all. Doesn't matter. Just don't look at their eyes. Then they can't read your eyes, you see. And it's just, you know, it's, everything's twisted. So you have to find your way through it. Right, so yes, like horses, we're blinkered. Now, do them and then I'll do. So, a bit of verse here, Matthew, and I might have these wrong, but I think it's Matthew 7:45 and Luke 6:42. How can you say to your brother, let me take the speck out of your eye? when you yourself fail to see the plank in your own eye. You hypocrite, first take the plank out of your own eye, and then you will see clearly to remove the speck from your brother's eye. Now this is what Jesus spoke. He spoke in parables, isn't it, to the people or to his disciples. And basically he's saying, you know, how can you tell me what you see when you've got blinkered eyes, when you've got planks in your own eyes, when you've got your own programming? How can I rely on you to say what you see? Because this is what happens, is we need a mirror reflection of ourselves. But if those that are put around us and the people that are in our world are either family or friends that have been placed around us, because for sure the people around you, if they don't want them around you, your handlers will remove them from your life. And if they do want them around you, they will allow them in your life. And yes, there is sort of some flexibility, because they can't stop everyone I see on the street just now. But what they'll do is try their hardest to stop me seeing people on the street, so, or talking to people on the street, and so that they can limit who we talk to. And if those people we talk to have got their own blinkered eye vision of perception of how to see the world, how to see you, how you need to be seen, like as in no value and so forth, then they will perpetuate that. So if they've got planks in their own eyes, how can they see what's in your eye? Who are they to say? So also 1 Peter 5.8, be sober-minded, be watchful. Your adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour. And he does. And I mean, he's got all his little workers for him. It doesn't have to be just the devil prowling around. He's got anyone who's working on his behalf, which is quite a lot. So he's saying, be sober in your mind. Don't be out of your head so you can't think, perceive straight. You need to be watchful. You need to see what's going on, so that when they come in your way, then you can move out of the way. Matthew 15:14, let them alone. They be blind leaders of the blind, and if the blind lead the blind, both shall fall into a ditch. So yes, instead of interacting with these people that will reinforce your programming, come away from them, let them be alone. Let them go leading the blind amongst the blind, and let them go in a ditch, but they won't be putting you in a ditch with them. And that's what you need. This is how they want us to experience, this is how they keep us in line, is with shame. And what they'll do is teach us that shame, we're not good enough. So to devalue us from childhood, so you're dehumanized in the cage, dehumanized in the box, and it doesn't matter what you achieve, it will never be good enough. It's like, I used to swim, taught myself in a sense to swim. My dad would teach us at home on a chair. My dad was a top swimmer. But I would go and swim and say, oh, I did half a length. And he'd say, oh, do a length. And then I'd say, I did the length. Oh, we'll do two lengths. So nothing was ever good enough. But as well, that was just sort of basic home, but that was reinforcing deeper programming. I mean, also, like, I remember in school, I didn't do any work. I was seen as out of control, so that I could be sent to the head, to be sent elsewhere, really. But I was very good at maths. And I remember like getting 98% one year for maths. And I hadn't done any maths all year, so, you know, teachers weren't pleased. But the thing is, yes, it wasn't, wow, 98%, well done. It wasn't 100%, was it? Wasn't 100, wasn't perfect. So unless you have perfect, it's not good enough. And even when you could get perfect, it still wouldn't be good enough. It's like they would find a fault. Never will you be shown that you're good enough. So it's like they'll tell you you're deluded if you think you're good at maths. Because I don't have an O-level maths, because when it come to me wanting to do O-level maths, no, they were putting me in with the most thickest children in the school. to do maths to prove that I, because they didn't want me in the O-level maths class because I might disrupt them because I was so naughty. So I had to prove myself, which was then by that time I'd missed algebra and logarithms and all that, so how could I sit the exam? So I didn't get the O-level maths, no, but I'm sure I could do it standing on my head. But because I haven't, then I get told I'm deluded by some. And this is back to psychological Tavistock invented terms to keep people in line. You know, they're delusional, they're paranoid delusional. And so you can't really, you know, how can I tell you, oh, I'm really good at maths, but then I know I'm really good at maths, and I know that that's what they would have liked in me, amongst other things, because my dad was very good at maths and very good at discernment and gambling, and so was mum. And I didn't do bad, 98%, considering I didn't do any maths. So then, you know, so again, it's like that's to shame you. Then you end up having to be reliant on yourself. And then that means that you're bigging up, and then you sound like arrogant, like you've got an ego. Like now, because I've said all that then, so that's my ego. And then you have to sort of nurture your ego, because no one else will. So it's all a bit of a paradox, and you're all a bit stuck. You have to become self-reliant because you can't be reliant on others. But at the same time, they will try and stop you maturing in other areas of your life because they need to keep you dependent on others. They don't want you to be self-reliant, only on certain things. And then when you're dependent on others, then they can put you down for being dependent. Oh, you know, we have to help you. You can't help yourself. You need to do for self. So that all makes you feel inferior. They tell you, they told me I was subnormal, you know, and devalued, dehumanized, belittled. And belittled, I like that word, you see, because it explains a lot. Because in the altars, they freeze you at certain ages. So you will be little. We call them littles, like five-year-old altars and that are littles. Because they can only sort of process with a five-year-old mind, five-year-old understanding. They don't understand how old we are until they come forward. They're not brought forward unless they want them brought forward. Sometimes like to give birth and things like that, just to traumatize them more. So yes, be little is what they would like to keep you in your place. Stay little. Do you know what I mean? Cry, get upset, distressed, like a little would. And then they can put the shame on you again. So it's all like gaslighting, really, to say that you wrongly perceive things, to get you to, I did 98%, am I good at maths? I'm not, well, no, I haven't got the proof, I haven't got the O level, have I? So can't be. So it's all like a gaslighting to twist up your mind, and then those people who keep you in place, they've got gain from keeping you in place. It may make them feel like, well, you know, they don't feel great about themselves, but if you're less than them, if you've got faults, then if they remind you of them, then they're not as bad as you, are they? So this is how, you know, they keep people in pecking order, and like, you know, it's hierarchical, so the people at the top won't suffer like the people at the bottom. And they all don't want to be, you know, at the bottom. And it all helps to make you unstable. And then if you're unstable, then, well, you must need them, mustn't you? So there you go. I remember my dad or someone, and it keeps coming in my head, of can do what you want, but no one's going to take any notice of you. Yeah. So it's about... And it is, once you're in that box, no one's going to take any notice of you. And it's like now, I'm trying to get communication in my private life, and emails are not going, and da 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 da. And so it is this reinforcing of do what you want, but no one's going to take any notice. And yes, you know, I do a lot on the internet, and to a certain extent, then I'm watched, but hidden. So it's like this video will go up and it will get watched and it will show it's being watched, but it will also be hidden. It won't be in the search engines. If I put it on Facebook, people won't see it. Only certain select people will be shown it in their notifications, so that then it looks like, well, no, look, it was shown because they see, but it's always the same people that see. So what, all the other people don't watch? Well, that doesn't make sense, does it? And I'll show you a bit of that in a minute. So all this humiliation really and shame also then triggers one to work harder, because it's like it triggers a sort of rebellion of like, well, I'll show you, well, I will get through, because there's no alternative. If you don't show anyone, then you're just left there. So you have to. So it triggers an altar that comes to protect you, to protect your self-preservation, your ego, whatever, to be visible, to be heard, which is what, in a sense as well, they want to trigger. Because it's all back to front. It's like a loop of eight, if infinity. It just goes on and on and on. So, yes, they will play the game of making you visible, invisible. But it's all theatre. It's all acting. It's all, you know, they call it gang stalking, theatre, street theatre, all theatre. So, you know, because it's to make you, to try and steer you to do what they want you to do, conform or else. It's like, you know, you play ball, you're going to play ball or you get nothing. So you have to play along with the games, else you will get nothing. And you can try to negotiate your terms, but really they have a hell of a lot of power. And so you have to go along with it. And that leads me on to a poem, and I want to go onto the computer now. So I'll stop this video again and go back to the computer. So this is end of part three, Breaking Let's Speak. Okay, bye for now, bye. Okay, so now we're back to part four of No C Programming. And yeah, I wanted to show you that I have Blogspot. Oh, I'm not on the camera, sorry about that. I have Blogspot. Although it used to be okay, it's owned by Google, same as YouTube. And it don't really do me no favours now. Gradually it's become less and less. And as you can see here, this is the blog, Insights into Darkness Poetry, and I mean I put this in a book, but as you can see there's so much missing for me to try and put things into Blogspot that now they rearrange where I put things and so forth, so it's like I don't really use it no more to put things on, other than I might use it to store things on. So in this blog, the poems, there's one I wanted to read if I can, it's sunny today, about humiliation, because it links on to part three, which is where I stopped, about humiliation. I want to hopefully try and give you a concept of it if you don't know. So for some reason I called this Truth to My Youth, and I wrote it 10th of February 2015. Okay, so it says, humiliation and shame always to blame, silenced in a box with paradoxical locks, catch 22s, and either way ain't good, everyone saying what you should, leave you looking bad, insane and mad, because they can't see what pain you've had. Since a self torn apart, they hold the reins, steer the horse and cart. Lord, shine light on us to expose the truth. I stay by you and fight for youth. Meanwhile, cause to look so shame, wrong, misguided, and to blame. I know I did the best I could. I know my intentions were all good. I could have done no better, I do believe. But with Catch 22, their illusions deceive. They construct the world to perceive one way, whilst reverse goings-ons is what they play. But I use the shame that people gave me with blame to learn how the world would receive, how to explain topic of pain, meanwhile I need to grieve. Where they would fight, hard not to hear, these aspects I need to argue clear. But truth is truth, they know I don't play, so negativity I deflect away and contemplate a way to say the back to front truth, disturbing with proof. People awake to the underground with open eyes to hear the sound vibrating from my words of truth. Listen, Oh, sorry, I stand strong, a role model for youth, teaching love, dash the hate, speak the truth, its power's great. And that's the end of that poem. Now, the other thing I wanted to do, and I'll see if I can search online for it, is I wanted to show you something which I couldn't explain. So it's, you go into a website called who called me, yeah, and this website is quite good because I'm going to try and show you something. Now what we'll do is make up a number, 11 digits, isn't it? So we'll make up a number if we can, and I'll show you. So it goes like this. Let's say, I don't know who that is. Try. So we go 017, normally they go like that, 2 7 0 6 5 4 2 3, or whatever. We need 11 numbers. 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 8 9 10 11. So we see this number, we press it, and we say, who called me? And what you'll see is it's neutral. It says neutral, never, yeah? So no one is in Rochdale, apparently, and no one's ever called it, right? Now, the thing is, if I was just my own and I searched it again, it should come up as one search because I just searched. So let's see what it comes back with. And so you can do these sort of tests, and this will help to show you. And it's come back with two, as you can see, two, which means that's one for me and one for someone other. And this is how you can test if someone's on your internet, and obviously they are. But I can't do anything about it. I can't get them off. But it's a way of, you know, validating, because of all this shame, all this denial that they put us through to say that it's not happening, you know, no one's watching you online and all this rubbish. So there you go, you can show, yes they are, because here we proved it. And if you think, you know, and it comes back with just one, then you know, okay, no, that's not happening now. So that's that one. Now, I've just got to find my place. I've done that. Okay, I've run out of things. So now I'm going to chow down, because I've got 5 more minutes on this. I might as well use it. So the next thing, I've done the poetry. So yeah, I've got Higher Insight blog spots. But again, and then I'll show you something else that they've done with this. Is when we look at the stats, right? You go into the top, into the B, and because I'm signed in, it should show me my stats. That used to come with the stats were at the top of the page, and then it would tell you what countries were looking, but now they've reduced that even more. So what I'm seeing is they're gradually closing in the box tighter and tighter of what I actually obtain from the Blogspot, which is owned by Google, and that's not really freedom. Now here we go. So if I go to the stats, right, it should show the show one person in England looked, who won't be me, it will be that person we just found on their phone number search. And it doesn't mean they're watching while I'm doing either. It could be that they're watching, like they've got a machine, like robot, I think they call it, for watching. Now the thing is, my screen, my thing, don't go up. And if I move that along, so you can see, pages today, you can see under here, let me just move that. Pages today viewed 1, so that's their machine. Yesterday 2, that's probably me looking. Now the thing is, down at the bottom, it would show you the country, but it won't do it, yeah, because they've made it that
the bar on my right, it won't go down. So if I want to know who, what country was looking, then I would need to move that back, go to the audience. Oh, my ears are all going blocked. Go to the audience, they take forever because they're not going to be pleased with what I'm doing here, are they? Right, and so it shows, I can see there that that's America more than Russia, England and France, right? I can tell, but when I try to, like in normal people's accounts, they could scroll it up and see where, but no, not for me, that's as high as I can go. So I have to know the map, and it, I can't tell the numbers. Do you know what I mean? Other than I can see 2-2, so it's like, well, I can deduce. But therefore, I'm being restricted on information that I can have on my things, which other people are allowed. So I say, if you've got things that you want or things that you've seen online and you really like them and you want to keep copies, you best take screenshots and ice creams of them, because I think they will be removed. I mean, mine can be removed at any time, but at the moment they're just being restricted. It's just getting tighter and tighter. So that's my point. Okay, so that's end of part four now, and I will go over to the other side of the room and finish the next parts. So I don't remember what that is, but I hope you're still following. And so, bye for now. All right. Got 3 seconds. Okay, so we're back to breaking OC section 5, I think it is. Hope so. I think so. Yes, 5. Right. And so we're still on health, really, and well, I've done the eyes and how that sort of doesn't help, and it doesn't help you read and learn, but keep looking. And also it's the legs. My legs are a major problem, and they feel like they've been tied. I mean, if I describe, then they feel like they've been tied up, and the circulation is so poor from above my knees down that it swells up. And I do exercises every day to try and help the flow, and it does help the flow, but as soon as I stop, it just swells back up again. And I do things like bath and everything to stop the swelling, because yes, they want you to stay in. And what a lot of people going to talk and see is, oh, you know what, they want you to stay in, stay isolated, so no one sees you, so you're invisible, and you just get on with whatever task they want you to do indoors. And it may just be watch telly, because they may use you at night, so they may want you tired in the day, just watch telly, just watch you know, some rubbish TV, and then at night we can access you and use you for what we want you for, and you haven't worn yourself out, and we know where you are, and you haven't mixed with anyone, you haven't come out of your box. So yes, my legs swell and they buckle and they become very uncoordinated. I mean, I can walk along flat sometimes, we're all right, but as soon as we hit an incline, then I struggle, it strains my back. And if I walk fast, then all my feet feel uncoordinated and I feel like I could fall over at any time. And if I do fall over, which I do, then I break. Then I break arms, wrists, fingers, and so I don't like to fall over, and therefore it's all to keep you in. And but I use my hiking poles, and which the neurologist is what, who, you know, is a nice neurologist. He's, when he first examined me, I was first examined, and he did the tests thorough, and he could see I had really poor balance, and he told me to use the walking poles, because that would help to join the pathways in my brain of left and right, and because the scarring does show on my brain. So again, it's like, well, it's not really just in my head, is it? Although it is in my head, my brain. They're clever with their words. Stay indoors, so and work for free, isn't it? Because it's like, I work for free. I make all this, and then they can feed off of it, take the data, and then make big names for themselves at the Tavistock Clinic. Nice, that. Clever. So
lots games, which again I do on my website, because it's all like mind games, and they love mind games. They want you to stay in your mind, stay in your left brain, do not go to your right brain, do not be creative, do not do anything other than play games with them. Yes, it's about seeing the wood from the trees, isn't it? You need to be objective, you need to see clearer. So first you have to look, you have to be aware that you're being blinkered, so it's about looking more, and then you will start to see clearer. See that the shame is not your shame, it's their shame. They're the ones that have done the wrong. They're the ones that have abused and stolen and raped and pillaged and done all the wrong, all the evil, all these years. You haven't done that, yes? And if you do it in other altars, well, it's because you're oblivious to knowing you do it. But if I knew I was doing anything wrong, if I was aware, they know I wouldn't do it. And I don't know what I do. So we have to turn the shame from us back on them by exposing them. And once they're exposed, it's magic, isn't it? Once you expose how the magic's done, it don't work no more. So I'm trying my hardest to break it as best I can for everyone. My dad used to say, watch and you may learn something. It'd be a bit swearing involved in there as well, but it'd be like, shut up. Watch and you might learn something. And so yes, there was a lot of watching and learning. When I was a child, I would look at books. I wouldn't read them with words. I would look at the pictures, watch and learn how people do things. And I used to have look and learn books of pets. And I've got a bit of scripture, I might as well go through it. Son of man, you live in the midst of the rebellious house, who have eyes to see but do not see, ears to hear but do not hear, for they are a rebellious house. Timothy 4:4. But blessed are your eyes because they see, and your ears because they hear. For truly I say to you that many prophets and righteous men desire to see what you see and did not see it, and to hear what you hear and did not hear it. John 5:24. And last one here, Ezekiel 12:2. Hear you deaf and look you blind that you may see. Who is blind but my servant, or so deaf as my messenger whom I send? Who is so blind as he that is at peace with me, or so blind as the servant of the Lord? You have seen many things, but you do not observe them. Your ears are open, but no one hears. This one here. He said, go and tell this people, keep on listening, but do not perceive. Keep on looking, as Trump would say, but do not understand. Render the heart of this people insensitive, their ears dull and their eyes dim. Otherwise they might see with their eyes, hear with their ears, understand with their hearts and return and be healed. So yes, it's to hear with our ears, understand with our hearts and return and be healed. Ecclesiastes 5:1. This leads you on to, well, it leads me on to denial. And denial is a major, and it's all part of their psychology. Sigmund Freud, who was, you know, Mason, was part of the cult, was, you know, builder of psychoanalysis, who's behind all the Tavistock, and I mean he validated paedophilia with the Oedipus complex and all that. Very likely a paedophile himself, let's get real. He did a lot of work on defense mechanisms, and yes, he does explain them well. And defense mechanisms are a psychological way that our selves cope with things that are a struggle emotionally, spiritually, mentally. And one of the defense mechanisms that he covers a lot is denial. And denial is really disassociation, but disassociation is like, denial can be like you're aware of what you're saying isn't true, to right at the other end of the spectrum where you don't even know that you don't even know you do it, because you're so disassociated, you're so unaware of that you are a separate altar. But denial is a starting point. And and they say what you can't see won't help you, hurt you, and people can't cope, so don't want to see denial. They blind their eyes. Yeah, so it is. It's about, you know, when the people that I'm talking of earlier who are reinforcing what was already put in program, you can try to, I've tried it, to bring them to an awareness, and so that they can see too what you see, but instead they will reinforce back down what they've been programmed to see, and to push you to question what you're starting to see. So you go in and you'll find that you'll go in and out of denial because you'll become aware, but then the people around you will reinforce the old thinking, the old perception, that will block that awareness, that you'll start questioning, maybe I'm wrong, maybe them dots are freckles after all, you know, maybe I poked myself in the eye or something like that. So they'll do everything to dismiss and deny. Acts 26:18, to open their eyes so that they may turn from darkness to light and from the dominion of Satan to God, that they may receive from givenness of sins and even inheritance amongst those who have been sanctified by faith in me. Proverbs 1:20-33, wisdom shouts in the street. She lifts her voice in the square. At the head of the noisy street, she cries out. At the entrance of the gates in the city, she utters her sayings. How long, O naive one, how will you love being simple-minded? And scoffers delight themselves in scoffing, and fools hate knowledge. And it is, because when you try to give the information, it's about they ridicule your perception and scoff at the knowledge that you have gleaned. Instead of saying, that's true, they automatically push it back and say, no, it can't be true. But seeing is believing, is what they say. But seeing isn't believing. Seeing is believing for scientists. Scientists say, oh, if we've got proof, then we will believe it. If we can't prove it, it's not believable. We can't take it on. And this was lovely to introduce science into it, that everything has to be measurable. But so much is not measurable in this world. And therefore, like denial, how do we, you know, where's the test? I don't even want them to set up the test to measure denial. But you can see that it's like, no, seeing is not believing, because they present fake truths. 2 Corinthians 5:7, for we live by faith, not by sight. And it is, if we go on what we see, we will be easy tricked. Romans 8:24, for in this hope we were saved, but hope that is seen is no hope at all. Who hopes for what he can already see? It's like Sting. The other day, who was it? Someone died in their big names. I can't remember who it was. But on the same, around the same time, it was some woman singer. On around the same time, on the right-hand side of Facebook is sponsored ad. Sponsored. That means someone's put the money in. That means it had to go through a process, had to be approved, had to be paid for, and is trackable. And there was an ad there, and I saw it, Sting. Sting's dead. And I was like, oh, Sting's dead, and someone else had died. And then I spoke to someone else, and I said, oh, Sting's dead as well. And they said, no, is he really? I said, yeah. And then I went and searched it on Google or somewhere, Sting dead, and it was a fake. It was a fake news. Now, the thing is, it was fake, But it was in the sponsored section, so it wasn't someone posted it, but they, oh yeah, it went out on Facebook, twist with words, right, fake news that he was dead. And it wasn't, it was a sponsored ad, so therefore you can find the culprit who's spreading fake news, and it's not anything to do with people on news feeds, and you'd think that they'd monitor, so what, we can just put ads for anything. But you see, again, they just want to clamp down on our freedom of speech. And so they probably sponsored it themselves. Now I want to, yes. Have I done that? I think I've done that. Local things which are seen. 2 Corinthians 4.18, while we look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For then things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal. And it is. Now, I wanted to show you, so this is the end of part 5. And I'm going to do part 6 on the computer. So bye for now, and I'll be back. Hopefully, of breaking no C programming. And it's about, I just come across, because I remembered, I thought, you know, brainstormed, and I remembered Free Blind Mice. And I found this page, and it's quite interesting. It says the origins of the tale of Free Blind Mice, the origins of the word of the Free Blind Mice rhyme are based on English history. The farmer's wife refers to the daughter of King Henry VIII, Queen Mary I. Mary was a staunch Catholic, and her violent persecution of Protestants led to the nickname of Bloody Mary. The reference to farmers' wives in Free Blind Mice refers to the massive estate which she and her husband, King Philip of Spain, possessed. The Free Blind Mice were three noblemen who adhered to Protestant faith, who were convicted of plotting against the Queen. She did not have them dismembered and blinded, as inferred in the Free Blind Mice, but she did have them burnt at the stake. Another nursery rhyme which features Bloody Mary can be found as following: Mary, Mary, quite contrary. So here is the Queen, and so the Free Blind Mice was about, they were set up to do her, and she did them back, drawing of the Queen Mary. And our illustration of the rhyme, Free Blind Mice, Free Blind Mice, see how they run, see how they run. They all ran after the farmer's wife, who cut off their tails with a carving knife. Did you ever see such a thing in your life as Free Blind Mice? Free Blind Mice. So that is where that come from. So I thought I would show you that. And I just want to show you, because I've got 10 minutes left. So I've done that, Free Blind Mice. Yeah, also they make one very invisible on the net. And this is what spurred that. Where are we up to? We can take these out. Because what they do is hide everything that I do. So it does get disheartening of why bother. I mean, I wrote this book, can't move that now, called Stop Using Crack Cocaine and Reclaim Your Life. And it's published paperback, it's cheap, affordable, look, $5.99. And yes, it's like, it's hidden, it's not selling, but it should be selling, because it's like, this was my specialist area, was working with crack cocaine users 20 years plus. And the videos get watched on YouTube and so forth, but I don't know what's happening there. And I mean, I've got other books on how to work with crack users that I'll show you, using in my Amazon author page, if it will go there. And in there, for a while they were playing this game with this book of how to work with men, and they were making the price £91, £106. I don't know if it's been used for gambling or what. Now they've got it at no price, But you can see it is affordable. If we scroll down the page, you can see it's affordable. It's $9.58. So there's one of all the poems, and there's one of How to Work with Women. But yes, I get hidden, the same as we say, to be not seen. And meanwhile, I'm doing all I can to help others. But it's a bit crazy because I don't get far. I found this woman, I'll put it here. Her name's Natasha News, Truth, Justice, Republican Life Coach. This is her there. She explains similar to what I explained, so maybe worth having a look. I'll link her into my video at the top. And yes, out of sight, out of mind. And it is sight, isn't it? S-I-G-H-T and S-I-T-E. And I mean, they choose their words wisely. Yesterday my computers were taken out and my tablet, so neither worked, and I've got something in my other computer saying now, oh, this isn't really Windows or something. Well, it's been Windows for enough years now, but it ain't no more. And I couldn't get the tablet. The tablet was doing its own thing. And so basically they'd taken over. I mean, yeah, I showed you earlier how there is someone watching, but they took over. But the way to deal with that is, when they take over all your devices, is to switch everything off. Switch all the things off, the modem, everything, all the computers off, and restart. And I think you get a new, like, number. I don't know what the numbers are, but I think you get a new one. So that's how I solve that sort of thing. So if you have the same sort of interference, just turn everything off and start again, and you'll be all right. So final song is one by Chris. It was done by Chris Montez, The More I See You. And it does sound a little bit like it was used in programming. And if you look at who sung it, it indicates it was in programming. I'll put it on the page that I make for my website when I make it. It goes, the more I see you, the more I want you. Somehow this feeling just grows and grows. With every sigh, I become more mad about you, more lost without you, and so it goes. Can you imagine how much I love you? The more I see you, as years go by, I know the only one for me can only be you. My arms won't free you, and my heart won't try. And yes, we get bonded with people, whether we like it or not, and you have to break all them bonds. But that's not no see, that's other. But it's good to see who's around you, see who are the people in your life, see other people who are reinforcing what she would call, this woman here, toxic people. Anyone that's reinforcing the program, you need to sort of look at getting rid of them from your life, because they're not helping you break free. It's not their job to, it's not what they're programmed to do. So I think that'll do for now. So I hope that I've helped you to see the programming in your life and see solutions to it, which is to look and to see who's around you, what's around you, and believe, you know, in what you see. Okay then, have I got any more of this? Romans.